you know, you need to think about a single use case and you're really focused on how you build software and how you support software. And if you did this right, then we can actually go and help grow businesses too over time, which is where CRM really comes in. So the idea is to go walk to the developer and the product manager and then walk with them to where we want them to be. We can't be sitting here and saying, you have dev CRM. They're like, what are you talking about? I don't deal with CRM. That's someone else's job. So we have to walk over to where they are, you know, talk their language, you know, make sure we pass the Meyer test, you know, speak the language of software and, you know, engineering software, building products and dealing with product managers. You know, that alone, if you can just converge product managers and developers in one system so that PMs are not planning in a planning tool, the moment they come out of that offsite of planning, it's there. And then real work is happening in someplace else, whether it's Slack or Jira or someplace else. You know, so I think just converging the product manager and the developer in one place will be great success in the coming 2 to 3 years.
Hi everyone. Before we begin, I would like to share that this podcast is brought to you by Prime Venture Partners, an early stage VC fund led by Amit Somani, Shripati Acharya and Sanjay Soni. Prime is often the first institutional investor in category defining tech startups in fintech, SaaS, healthcare, and education, such as MyGate, Quizzes, Planet Spark, Bolt, and Clip. To know more about Prime, visit primevp.in.
Hi, this is Siddharth Aluwalia. Welcome to the 100x Entrepreneur Podcast. Today, I'm very excited to have Dheeraj Pandey, co-founder of Nutanix and co-founder of DevRev, on our podcast. Dheeraj, your journey has been so amazing. You built Nutanix as the largest independent hybrid cloud provider, and this journey took you 10 years. And now you are back again as an entrepreneur building DevRev, the one-stop CRM tool for devs, where you know you take away all the complexity of business tools from their life and make it so simple for them. So Dheeraj, first of all, welcome on the podcast.
Thank you, Siddharth, and appreciate the opportunity.
Dheeraj, so I would like to start with, you know, in both your journeys at Nutanix and DevRev, how did you achieve the process of product market fit? Let's step back and What were you thinking in your first journey? Deep dive into it till the stage of product market fit. How did you process it? And now in the second journey, how you're doing it and how both of them are different?
The first, you in many ways had the answer in your question. The word is journey, it's not a destination. So you have to look at product market fit like that. It's like any other relationship between two entities. You know, here there's a product and there's a market. And just like most things, like for example, love, you know, it happens gradually and then suddenly. So in many ways, PMF is like that as well. I think the act of listening is very important, you know, and what I mean by that is, you know, this tightrope walk between the things that you're going to be stubborn about and the things that you're going to be flexible about. So at DevRev, we are trying to really codify this process of product market fit. And what we have come to really sort of coalesce is like these three pillars of velocity, convergence, and delight. You know? So the first one is, are you listening fast enough and responding fast enough? That's velocity. The second one is convergence, where you're negotiating with the market on less is more. Because, you know, you're young, you're early, they would like to have everything and the kitchen sink in your product. And you are trying to find innovators and early adopters who are not looking for everything, but they look for the one 10x. So when you're having that negotiation, you know, you're trying to figure out how less is more candidates are the ones that you actually qualify and really build with, so that, you know, they become champions and they can build their careers on this as well and the advocates they need to be. So that's convergence, you know, with the market. And the last one is delight, because when you're going that fast with velocity and the act of listening and patching code and upgrading it 5 times a day, how do you not forget about the little things? You know, the Japanese call it kodawari. You know, it's the little things that matter, and it's the pursuit of excellence and perfection in many ways, which you can never get to, but it's a great journey. So, you know, we did this at Nutanix. We were always, you know, very, very high velocity with our customers. And I think it created this dopamine effect with them as well, because they're like, oh, they're coming back. And even though they're not perfect, you know, they're really agile, and then, you know, negotiating with those who are willing to look at less is more as a virtue, and finally, you know, what delight means to them.
So let's take the first 2 years of Nutanix, right? How did you identify that problem which was so large to be solved? And did you have a smaller problem when you started getting your first 10 customers at Nutanix?
Yeah, I wish it were a science, you know. I think a lot of it is an art as well. But I think what we were really trying to do is to simplify stuff. You know, we knew that building a just yet another mousetrap is not going to work. And at the same time, we needed a killer app, you know, a use case that could basically showcase the value of convergence, which is basically the story that Nutanix was. I mean, you know, we were talking about this earlier with you about how the public cloud was really a story of convergence, you know. Rather than having those many buying centers, you know, in infrastructure, there was server, i.e. compute buying centers, storage buying centers, networking buying centers, security buying centers, and tons of decision makers. You know, what the public cloud did was to make it atomic and miniaturize the whole experience, where you could bring it all together and converge the experience for the developer, who was never supposed to be a buying center to begin with in traditional IT and the old world of on-premise data center hardware and infrastructure. So the idea is to actually, you know, go to some of these people and talk about whether they believe in this simplified experience. And that's what we really did, is to talk about, look, we've converged everything in pure software. It's running in commodity hardware. And by the way, it gets rid of this dependence on too many other people, which is basically the shadow IT that public cloud also engendered in many ways. The idea that you don't have to go and beg, borrow from people who are never going to listen to you. You can just come to us and you can rent it from us, and you can pay by the cent and the dollar, as opposed to hundreds of thousands of dollars, if not millions of dollars. And the first 10 customers, I think some of it was, you know, a lot of begging and a lot of groveling and relationships and network. And the early on stuff is about friends, you know. Can you find friends who are willing to make a bet on you? And I think finally these innovators and early adopters who really believe in the idea of rebellion. They're like, look, we have to do something that's contrarian. And you work with them and you make them look good. And along the way, you look good as well. So it becomes a virtuous cycle of these folks who are not just going to be your users, but also evangelizers over time as well.
So the main value prop for them was walking away from heavy, expensive on-prem?
Yeah, the idea that you had to depend on six other departments to make a decision. And the fact that you could atomically consume it in a very small scale and then grow over time. You know, so I think that was the brilliance of anyway the public cloud, that look, you can start really small and you can pay as you grow. We brought that to the data center as well. You know, and honestly, that's basically what the whole cloud movement is all about. It's like, can you make it so small that I don't have to make a call? In fact, going forward in the world of PLG and freemium, it's being pushed to the limit where I don't even have to pay for it. Right? And could you have such a economized cloud model where the early user doesn't have to pay for it? Let them go and get hooked, and then you go and figure out what, you know, monetization really means.
But who pays the salary and then that?
Well, I mean, first of all, you have to really engineer your cloud where you can have millions of free users. And we're doing that at DevRev right now, where we have to miniaturize each tenant. You cannot spin up, you know, big things per tenant, because then you won't be able to really give it out to freemium users like the way you do in the world of open source, where, you know, people just start to try it out. And especially in the world of developers, they are always skeptical about paying for something upfront, because they're engineers, they're developers, they're makers. They're like, look, I'm not going to really believe in you and trust you until I trust you. And when they trust you, they really trust you. So I think you have to engineer a cloud that way. And that's the way B2C was done. I mean, basically each shopping cart was not charged for until you really checked out. You know, I mean, I could have a shopping cart that was not checked out for days, if not weeks, and they would send me reminders and stuff. And, you know, browsing the catalog in an e-commerce site was not something that you had to pay for. So there are many things, many experiences in the world of SaaS that will actually look like that. And there's some great companies in the world of PLG today where you don't charge everybody. You don't have to get greedy upfront, where maybe the people who are creating stuff are charged, but the people who are reading that creation, they don't get charged, and so on.
So, Dheeraj, you as an entrepreneur have an affinity to solve large problems. But can you, for our listeners who are entrepreneurs, share the process of how to identify large problems? I believe when you were exiting Nutanix, right, you would have definitely considered 10 problems. And this is a very, the problem you're solving at DevRev for developers is 180 degree opposite to that you were solving at Nutanix. So how did you identify large problems? That's my question.
Hmm. Well, you know, there is something to be said about having a passion for a theme. That theme in most entrepreneurs' lives is really about simplifying, you know. And it's a journey, you know, and you look at some complicated processes. So at Nutanix, we had 2,000 developers, you know, including engineers and developers. And they loved Slack. They didn't like Jira. And they liked the customer contact. So, you know, even though we had 3-4 departments between them and the end user, they always liked the customer conversation, especially the on calls and, hey, tell us more about why you need what you need so that we can go and build this. And when they heard directly from the customer, they actually had more empathy for the end user, you know. And the customers liked it too, that look, I don't have to go through 6 different layers and this game of Chinese telephone, you know, which is like, you know, the moment somebody says something and then goes through 7 layers of translation, it gets lost. So both sides liked it. And I think that was the aha moment for us that, look, Slack has made it near real time, but it's relatively expensive to engage with customers in Slack. The back office tool, which is built for product development or engineering, you know, is not collaborative enough. You know, Jira was not collaborative enough. Everybody still, if you go to Twitter, you know, hear everybody talk about its interface and how slow it is and so on. Great innovation for its time, and you know, obviously great innovation in PLG being a freemium product from day one. I think the aha moment came to us that, look, we underestimate the, you know, the real aspiration of the developer is to hear and to listen. And of course, product managers actually come and play a vital role there. But also the customer's aspiration to be heard can be solved through this new thing. So I think this idea that everything has to be made as simple as possible and no simpler is a really hard business problem. And in this, you will sometimes go and try to redefine business processes and business roles. And those are really hard challenges because now you're going and challenging status quo and incumbency and people's roles and responsibilities. But if you have the staying power, I think these are the biggest and the baddest things that can happen in you know, pretty much any software vertical, I would say. And nothing has been easy, and anything that's large has never been that easy. So I feel like, you know, if you take this customer-centric mentality of simplification and how you need to keep making things simpler, you will hit upon trying to solve hard problems.
But there are two schools of thought. Some school of thought say find a very niche problem, then expand. Solve, like Paul Graham says, like find 100 customers who love you. But on the other end, there's also saying that, right, solve for the largest market.
Well, I think there is a compromise because, you know, nothing in life is really one way or the other. It's a paradox. You know, most things in life are schizophrenic decisions. You know, I would say the balance is, even if you're solving a very large problem, find a use case that is easy to get dopamine on. And that is what becomes viral. Because once you've built that little trust, because remember, trust is only built a bite size at a time. You cannot build, you know, a vast amount of trust with anybody overnight, you know. So that's where the compromise is, that can you provide this little dopamine every month, every quarter? And then your current users will try out new features and new capabilities and the expanded story from you. But the wedge has to be simple enough where they don't have to suspend their belief. Like, hey, can it really be that big? You know, how can it be that big and, you know, ever so promising and so on? So there are many things in DevRev that we do within the company, but we're never going to expose and market it to the end users because it's like, we have the curse of knowledge. We know a lot. We live with it. We are in this echo chamber of what DevRev is. And like, hey, we can do a lot of things. But you don't want to really expose it. It has to be progressive sort of divulgence of what you really do and so on. Because then people are willing to trust you one feature at a time, one quarter at a time, you know, one $5,000 at a time. So.
DevRev is now right now in beta, right? And you have a few hundred beta customers.
Mm-hmm.
What's your simplest value prop to a developer that you attract and employ? And what the first moment of aha dopamine that you give it to them? Right?
I think the most important one is social. That the system that they come and log on every day is not one that their manager is forcing them to log on to. It's a place where they can collaborate with others. It has a multiplayer sort of dynamic built into it. It's highly real-time, highly social, and it basically takes care of the chores that otherwise you need a lot of program managers for, and people shouting on you and saying, hey, why isn't this done? Why isn't that done? So we're trying to really take a lot of these chores, a lot of these awkward conversations of project management away, and providing a lot of serendipity where you find similar work and you find, you know, how to route things to the right people and so on, all through machine learning, you know. And there's a big data problem here, you know, because a lot of work is actually being seen in some form before, you know, a crash, a failure, you know, a log file, a stack trace, you know, these kind of things have been seen before. Even feature requests coming through the top of the funnel, you know, when product managers trying to figure out how do you really cluster them, you know, these things can be solved by machines, you know. And if you can really let the machine fight fires, then product managers and developers can really focus on doing the things that really matter, because it's a highly paid role. I mean, you know, a software developer's role is probably the most expensive role coming out of school. So we need for them to be freed up of the chores of trying to assign blame or attribute change management issues or similar work and things like that. And at the same time, if you can make it fun with emojis and high fives and, you know, even getting the thank you note from the end user, I think that's what makes people come to work. I mean, the problem is that today they're being forced to log on to a tool that is good at dashboarding and reporting, but that's where managers hang out. Developers hang out in Slack because that's where fun happens, you know. So the thing is, can you really bring it together where you can still do dashboarding and historical analysis and burn down charts and all sorts of things where managers hang out for planning, but at the same time, that's where real work happens.
So essentially, you are saying that you are going to replace Jira because that's a project management tool used by developers to file tickets.
Yeah, I mean, if we become successful enough, obviously right now in the large enterprise, we have to sit next to these things. I mean, that's Maya. You know, there's we were talking about PMF, product market fit. There's a very interesting acronym that I learned maybe 5 years ago, MAYA. And it was introduced by a very famous designer, Raymond Louis, in the US, who had come up with some big brands and created these brands in the US. And Maya stands for most advanced yet acceptable. So Google glasses fail the Maya test. Because if you're wearing glasses in front of me and I don't even know whether you're recording what I'm talking to you, it's basically awkward for me. It's just socially unacceptable for me to know that you're recording everything I'm talking about. So Maya is important in a new idea, a new concept. So we're trying to make sure that while we are most advanced, we're also acceptable. So in the large enterprises where they actually have these incumbent tools, we have to sit next to it. We have to do two-way syncs with them. We have to handshake it, make sure that we don't go and disrupt what they've actually invested in. But, you know, we'd love to grow with startups who don't know anything different. They're like, oh yeah, I mean, PLG is the way to be, and my developers are social and they'd like to know more about what end users are doing. And it's not only in the hands of a product manager to bring product market fit. You know, let that be a collective thing. And if you start to think that way, maybe more startups will actually have product market fit, as opposed to this loss in translation that happens because the developers have no idea why something is being done. And there's lots of cognitive biases that come in too. So if you can unify this thing where the developer's getting things in real time, and yet, you know, there is a way to put PMs and support people in the middle for more evolved companies, but that doesn't mean you need three tools. You can use security permissions and roles and privileges in one system if you had more evolved support and more evolved product management and project management and things like that. But ideally, it doesn't have to be in three different tools. And that's where you get the real-time updates between these departments and get to know the end user and so on.
Dear listeners, before we dive further into the podcast, I would like to welcome Prashant Kanti, Head of Product Management at Zoho Payroll and Zoho Books.
Prashant, where do founders usually struggle with payroll and how can they fix it?
Thanks, Siddharth. Founders want to give their best for their employees. And they realize very early on, right, payroll and compensation is a very, very important part of what they are going to handle. However, what we have seen is where they miss out is usually on finding out the best solution that can grow along with their business. And that's where, for example, the payroll complexity can grow very quickly. Initially, when you have just four or five employees, that's okay. But when the employee size keeps on, the payroll complexity grows by leaps and bounds. So it's best for founders to invest in payroll automated solutions right at the very start. So they have one less thing to worry about.
Thank you, Prashant. Dear listeners, you will find more about Zoho Payroll in the show notes. Now, let's further continue with the podcast.
Dheeraj, 10 years ago, for every enterprise software or even software, the target market was enterprise, right? Go to enterprise and even that you did with Nutanix, right? You went to enterprise and go on-prem and say, hey, there's a better solution, there's a cheaper solution, use us. Today, what I'm hearing from you is a different thing, right? You are not going to enterprises, you're going to startups. If I told a VC 5 years ago that my target audience is going to be startups, they would laugh at me. And still today, VCs laugh if I tell them, right, my target audience, if I'm building a software tool or a software platform, is going to be startups. Why are you then targeting startups? Are startups not more vulnerable? Because any startup today can shut down. Right. And 80% of your customers won't exist tomorrow because just...
there's Darwinism in anything. You know, the important thing is if the cost of sales is minimum and if they can bake your product and you can evolve your thinking with these younglings, then the larger segment of the market is more accepting. This is true between mid-market and enterprise as well. You know, initially, you never build a company directly for the enterprise. You build it to the mid-market and then if you have the ambition, you grow to the large enterprise. This happened with pretty much every company. I mean, you look at AWS is doing probably 50 billion now, but initially when they
70.
Started. Yeah, 70 billion now. And I think when they started, they were just working with companies that were willing to take this path less traveled. And some of them just happened to, you know, really become the black swans of the business. And I think that's always going to be true. You know, you start with enough saplings. You know, I mean, you start with seeds. Not every seed becomes a sapling. And you nurture some of these saplings and they become plants. And plants become trees. And enough trees become sequoias, you know. So it definitely is a time-tested strategy. The question is, are you evolving fast enough with these growing businesses? And at the same time, are you bringing enough configurability? Because that's what the enterprise needs, configurability. All the itties that you hear about, security, and including the idea of different roles and role-based access control and things like that. So if you're building for that, eventually you'll get to the enterprise as well. But I think it's always smart to actually start with something smaller, whether you start with startups and go to mid-market, or they start from mid-market, go to the enterprise, and before ending up with the largest enterprise. Because these larger companies, they're also, by definition, they're paid not to take risks. And you also end up making a very lumpy business that is very hard to predict, which is why many of these lumpy businesses, they never go public. Because water, it's so hard to predict your numbers. And you're the mercy of a very consolidated, unfragmented market. You know, ideally, as entrepreneurs, we all want a highly fragmented market. But there's something to be said about 80-20, you know. I mean, the best ones will eventually go and get 80% of the business from 20% of their customers. And even within that, there's a Pareto of 80-20, where, you know, 4% will actually do 80% of that 80 or something. You know? But you really need to know whether you can build a product for these big customers over time or not. Some companies cannot get from SMB to the mid-market because they just didn't want to engage at the mid-market level to get the requirements for product and things like that. You know? And it wouldn't happen just through internet. you know, it has to happen with product managers and maybe some semblance of field reps and things like that.
But what you talk about product-led growth is very different from what enterprises accept, or even mid-market. Mid-market and enterprise accept somebody to be in a sales role, in an account role, to reach out to them.
I think you'd be surprised, like Adobe, we do almost $11, $12 billion in the DME business, digital media business. And we should not confuse users with buyers. So even in a PLG model, and you look at this in Atlassian and Stripe and Datadog and every such company that went on to do PLG successfully in the enterprise, they had to connect with the end users first and really create this grassroots rebellion, which then rose to the top of the C-level, you know, IT, CIOs and procurement people. Like, what's going on? We have these 50 credit cards, 50 cost centers. This must be a really popular thing. So you want these mushrooms to develop, you know, it's a mushroom cloud. And then over time, you deal with procurement with an enterprise rep who goes and consolidates these 50 cost centers into one cost center. But that is basically a very complementary activity. Initially, all these companies, they just mushroom by saying, look, we have to go and build a direct connection with the end user rather than go through a buyer and 3 years of a sales cycle, and who knows whether the end user will even engage and use the product or not. You know? So that's what's flipped in this model. PLG doesn't obviate the need for enterprise reps because eventually you have to box it into the budget and deal with procurement and all that. But the precursor to that, and by the way, it's a rite of passage to be there. You know, when you really have 50 cost centers, you know, it must be a really big company by then. But you know, the precursor to that is to build these mushrooms, you know, where each of them is individually using it, and maybe they're not even aware that there's so many different cost centers in the large company.
So let's talk about the history of product-led growth. I think somewhere it has to start with the seeds of AWS, how developers started using AWS, then companies like Atlassian came up, right? Then what you were just describing, right? The developer level was so huge within each enterprise that you said, hey, take away your credit cards, let us pay for it.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So what, if you can go and describe, because you would have observed it very closely.
Yeah, I mean, in fact, we all did. AWS succeeded because they were learning from their retail business. Because retail is sort of the epitome of PLG in some sense, where there's no salespeople. And everything is happening through the app and through the website. And I think the reason why AWS succeeded is because they looked at it with a childlike innocence to say, look, why can't you build an infrastructure business where you're selling through credit cards? If anything, you know, one of the biggest things that Jeff and Andy argued about was, do we ever have reps? Now, eventually they did put reps. They put reps a little later than when Andy would have wanted, because Azure was going and really winning the hearts and minds of Europe and places where, you know, they don't have as many makers. You know, there's a lot of people who are buyers as opposed to makers. You know, in the US, you'll still see a lot of people who do software development, but most companies in many verticals, they don't go build software, they buy software, and they operate software. So it's a different kind of model for them. But I think, you know, it all started out with the idea of thinking about cloud computing as a retail business, and then going and doing this well for the early stage startups and so on. But PLG has a few things now, as you look back at the last 15, 20 years of not just these cloud computing companies, but also, you know, companies like Stripe and Datadog and Figma and even Adobe for that matter. You know, I mean, as I mentioned, procurement doesn't come in. Initially, it's just the one user who starts to use your product, and then it becomes a little work group, another work group, and then eventually consolidate. I think the idea that you could use software even as a single person without having to go through a mega decision is at the core of PLG. The second one is SEO. I mean, the fact that you can intercept the intent of a searcher and bring them to you is a really hard problem. And obviously, Google kind of made it a formal sort of way to think about awareness and, you know, discovery. But discovery is a big deal in SEO as well. You know, it's really important to be discovered by someone who's not explicitly searching for you, but searching in the adjacency, which is the intent. And how you intercept that intent is basically how you solve this chicken and egg problem of discovery itself. You know? So I think it's a really, really important piece of the puzzle of PLG is discovery. And I think last but not the least is doing more things through the app. You know, what does it mean to really go to in-app pricing and in-app promotion and in-app placement and in-app training and education and so on? So you don't need lots and lots of salespeople. I mean, even the way sales should work in PLG, and again, this has been tested in the last 5-10 years, that, I mean, Snowflake and MongoDB, for example, in many ways are also PLG companies, even though they have enterprise reps, because the reps go and knock at the doors of companies that have already invested some. So it's a warm seat as opposed to a cold seat, where you like going and opening up a slide deck and saying, this is how you spell my company's name. So I think it's the idea of digging from both sides. You dig on awareness, grassroots up, and then if you have larger customers, you get your salespeople to go after warmer seats. Because now it's really, you know, cold start is a really hard problem. And this is how things used to be in Oracle, IBM, SAP days, cold start, you know, and 2-3 year sales cycles and then implementation costs and things like that, to where things are right now, where you can actually let your salespeople go after things that are already warm. And even marketing, I think it's, if you look at marketing and the funnel of marketing, in the old world, it was all about prospects, leads who never heard of you, people who threw their business card in an event where they were just window shopping and wanted a free t-shirt, you know, and you're just going after a lot of vacuous, noisy leads. To now, there's a world where you know you need to market to the freemium user who's already shown her intent to use your product. So why wouldn't you go and market to them and spend more time middle of the funnel rather than top of the funnel, which is full of noise and is full of lurkers who probably would never have ever used your product, you know? So PLG is really shifting things to the middle of the funnel, including for salespeople. And I think it's going to be more efficient because you're letting leads come in, have them sign up with no questions asked, no need to ask for money upfront, hook them into this, and really create an opportunity where they used all your features if possible. And maybe in a limited way, because, you know, obviously you have to make money and keep your lights on as well. But then you go and market to these people and really have them discover what this thing could be for them.
For our listeners who want to deep dive into product-led growth, can you describe in first principles how they should think about building with that philosophy?
Well, the word product-led says a lot about where it all begins. It begins with the product. But actually, even before that, it begins with engineering. Because if you don't have an honest engineering behind PLG, you'll never be able to do PLG. And I'll give an example for this. So if spinning up a new tenant or a new prospect is going to cost you thousands of dollars of customer acquisition, you know, within 6 months or something, then you'll never be able to do this across lots and lots of free customers early on. So you need to make sure that the sliver that you give out per tenant is probably no more than $5 to $10 for the whole year, because then you can live by all this stuff. And then you can go and eke out $200 a year from them, as opposed to $100,000. Because if you need to really eke out $100,000, you need salespeople, right? Nobody's going to give you $100,000 in one lump sum unless there's a human-to-human conversation and a six-month proof of concept and so on. So the idea is to atomize your product, you know, and to a point where each tenant and the cost of acquiring their tenant is low to mid single digit dollars in your cloud costs, you know, including maybe your marketing costs as well. Yeah. So that's where it all begins. Then you make sure that you open this up like a retail site would be open for any and every consumer, you know, and you don't have too many gates up front, you know, for what it means to sign up and use the product and so on. And then you need the nudges to start coming in, because changing habits is not easy. So just because you open them up for free sign up doesn't mean that they'll come back to you. So the way you get nudged when you leave a shopping cart unchecked out is the way they have to be nudged on things. And Again, small dopamine, small victories, you know, defining like, oh, if you did these 6 steps, like the way LinkedIn profile says, oh, you're 80% done, now you're 85% done and 90% done. You need to apply those kind of, you know, virtuous cycle things where you do a little thing and you find the dopamine, do one more thing, you find the dopamine. Is the consumer grade thinking of the e-commerce engines that you have applied to your product as well. And lastly, you know, you do everything in product, you know, where even though you might actually have, you know, a go-to-market strategy that includes some commercial reps or inside sales, you try to enable as much as possible by left shifting it to the product. You know? Because if all these things like pricing, promotion, placement of new features, discovery of new things is all going to happen through a slide deck, then you're not building PLG product. You know? Now, speaking on the other side of go-to-market, just because you're doing PLG doesn't mean that you might not have inside sales. But that inside sales team is user-aware. The clicks of the user, like who is doing more clicks that I can then go and call them rather than calling somebody who is barely logged in. Right? So there's a marketing team that will go and nudge them to log in more often. But then let the inside salespeople not waste their bandwidth on folks who are higher up the funnel versus those who are lower down the funnel. And only if inside sales is looking at users' activity and product activity will they be able to go and be more efficient as well. So the point here is that there'll be a hybrid world. The product will actually, you know, take the user to a certain point that it becomes interesting for humans to call them. And only if you do this well is your sales and marketing cost going to be such that you can really build a highly efficient sales and marketing business.
So I think there's nobody better to lead a masterclass on PLG than you. Let's say tomorrow.
Actually, you know, I tell you what, to be honest, Nutanix was all SLG. You know, we were spending $1 billion a year to go get $1.6 billion and so on. So I feel like, you know, I built a business which didn't take risks in distribution. You know, it was my first startup. Nutanix was my first startup. And what we're doing now is the opposite of that. You know, so I'm learning as we speak. And the real goal is if whatever we are learning, if we can codify it in our software, nothing like it. So at some point, if you were to succeed, hopefully we'll create an operating system around PLG, which is not a deck of slides. You know, it's really software and templates. And where do you begin when you're writing new code? And how do you really go and support customers? To how do you really go and grow your business?
So in a sense, DevRev tomorrow will also be a CRM for PLG products.
Absolutely. I mean, if you were to succeed, I mean, I think we are taking one step at a time, but identity is a big deal for us. And not just the identity of the developers and the product managers and support people, but also their customers. You know, so if they want people to think about end users, there's no system out there, you know, because the CRM tools were built for salespeople. And honestly, it's not customer relationship management. It is Salesforce automation. While CRM means customer relationship management, and that includes their clicks, their interests, their biases, what they do on a day-to-day basis, you know, and that is now stuck in product tools and analytics tools and user analytics tools, which has nothing to do with CRM. A good CRM will actually know about all those things and give it to the support people, give it to the customer success people, give it to the product managers and inside sales and so on. So I think we're in the very early innings of what this could look like, you know, in the future. And it's a lot of fun to really think about it on an empty canvas. And yet, I think we have a lot of mistakes that we'll actually make along the way, and we have to learn from that.
And Salesforce being the largest company in this space, like Salesforce almost like a 200 billion revenue company today.
200 billion market cap.
Market cap.
20 billion dollar
revenue company. They function not on based on user data. They function on data entered by the sales. What you say is such a huge opportunity.
Yeah, I mean, I think if you look at B2C companies today, they don't buy CRM tools, they build CRM, you know, and that's because the end user database doesn't exist. And I think it's a great opportunity to think about how would a B2B developer think like a B2C developer without having to reinvent the wheel. of many things about identity of the user and the clicks of the user and the biases of the user and the billing systems of the user and so on. It's all built from scratch in B2C companies. But many of these things have to be standardized over time. And I think, there's a great opportunity to think on an empty canvas like that and go, build something from scratch rather than really do it the way it was done in the last 30 years or so.
What are the risks of failure that you are mitigating right now?
I said this before, you need to think about a single use case and you're really focused on how you build software and how you support software. And if you did this right, then we can actually go and help grow businesses too over time, which is where CRM really comes in. So the idea is to go walk to the developer and the product manager and then walk with them to where we want them to be. We can't be sitting here and saying, you have dev CRM. They're like, what are you talking about? I don't deal with CRM. That's someone else's job. So we have to walk over to where they are, talk their language, make sure we pass the Meyer test, speak the language of software and, engineering software, building products and dealing with product managers. That alone, if you can just converge product managers and developers in one system so that PMs are not planning in a planning tool, the moment they come out of that offsite of planning, it's stale. And then real work is happening in someplace else, whether it's Slack or Jira or someplace else. So I think just converging the product manager and the developer in one place will be great success in the coming 2 to 3 years.
Now, going back, to building an entrepreneurial culture within a company, you were a champion at that, right? So I can attest that because 3 of the LPs in my fund are founders of the company that Nutanix acquired.
Yeah, we were about learning, it's this childlike mindset to continue to learn. And there was a lot that we learned from many of these. We talked about Aditya Sood at Calm or, Vijayapati at Minjar, Botmetric. They brought the cloud-like thinking and the developers and DevOps thinking to Nutanix. And I think the rest of the company learned a lot from them too. But what made them stick around was autonomy and mastery and purpose, things that Dan Pink talks about, motivation, as opposed to getting acquired and moving on within a year or so. But I think by and large, and you see this in many of the companies, like even Adobe, when we acquired Omniture back in 2009-10, is when we learned what SaaS is all about. Because before that, we were box software company, and we were still early, very, very early in our transition to subscription. So when you acquire such companies, right now Microsoft with GitHub, they're learning open source and developers and embracing developers of all kind, not just Windows, but also Linux and AWS and AI ML developers who will never use Azure but might end up using Google Cloud products and so on. So I think you acquire these companies because they help you evolve and keep you relevant.
How many companies you acquired during your journey?
I think it was 4. And
one was company by Vijay. Second one, Aditya by Calm. Third by Ranjan, who's now.
Yeah, that was project. A very small company, but there was a couple others. There was one called NetCell, which was in the world of observability. It was a US-based company. And there was one called Frame, which was a Serbia-based company. And they were cloud computing of a kind that we had never done before. So we learned a lot from them as well.
And the most difficult part of an acquisition is the integration. The founders we acquired, they get frustrated and they leave. How are you able to integrate them so well? You talk about mastery, autonomy, purpose. But there's a whole bunch of other things that come along with an integration.
I look at it like an hourglass. If you treat the founders and that team as a customer, and just the acquisition itself, which is like an event of sales, is not good enough. Once the thing settles down on the other side of the hourglass, that's customer success. And you have to really go and do a good job of customer success. I think I would give ourselves a 5 on 10 because it's that hard. And remember, you're dealing with rebels. They don't want to be, having their hands tied at their back in a larger company. The reason why they did what they did is because they wanted autonomy of a kind that they never would have gotten working for someone else. So you have to continue to evolve for them. And there's a lot of foreign organ rejection too. Many a time when the body, which is the incumbency, tries to reject it. And I think you have to make sure that you cut down on the bureaucracy, make sure that they're not like five levels away from you, and keep them really close and make sure you have them heard. And also, I think, you know, really go back to the body and say, look, this is a good organ and we can actually, you know, be a healthier body if you have this organ. So I think it's a penance. It's not easy. I think it's the word that the Japanese use is gaman. It's stoic endurance, you know. So when you integrate this, the stoic endurance of the new idea with the existing idea, and how do you really have them meld and become a better idea over time?
Dheeraj, now I want to go back like 20 years back, right? Or maybe more, 25 years back, and talk about your own journey. Right? Can you tell us more about your family, your roots, the city you came from?
Yeah, and for that you have to go back almost 40 years, you know, because I'm 46 right now, and I grew up in Patna. And when I was 16, almost 17, I came to for my undergrad at IIT Kanpur. I pursued my undergrad in computer science at IIT Kanpur. And when I was 21, almost 22, I came to the US. And basically, at an age of 21, I had a fork in the road. I could have joined Unilever here in India. I could have gone and done IT consulting at Deloitte, because in 97, this was the first year they had come directly to come and hire out of campuses in India. Or I could have gone and pursued PhD at either UT Austin, Urbana-Champaign, Columbia, you know, Southern California, USC, and so on. And I talked to one of my seniors, who was 2 years my senior. His name is Gokul Rajaram. And he's another really accomplished person in the Bay Area. You know, he was very early at Google, was a product manager for AdSense for like 7-8 years, then went to Facebook and built their entire ad business, and then was at Square for the longest time and so on. So I spoke to him and he's like, you know what, you need optionality. Don't commit to anything but a PhD. And so I ended up at Austin because I had a fellowship, so I didn't have to go work. And UT had basically said, look, we'll pay for everything, just come and be a PhD student. Which is exactly the same opportunity that Gokul had as well. So, and there was a little chasm I had to cross about buying a ticket to get to the US. And that's where Jain Tata Endowment and KC Mahindra Trust actually helped me get there. So I land in Austin, Texas. Within a year, I actually get to do my internship at Oracle in Redwood Shores, California. And that's when it was the height of the bubble, 1998, you know, nothing can go wrong, just like from 6 months ago, you can imagine. And I figured timing is everything. And I said, I'll take a leave of absence from a PhD and just finish my master's and go and be in the industry. So I ended up doing that. I started working for a company called Trilogy in Austin, Texas. Even Vijay was at Trilogy, by the way, but almost 10 years later after me. I worked there for a year and a half, and I think, you know, I had this itch to get to the West Coast, and I had a fork in the road again. I take a left turn, come to California, take a right turn, go to Microsoft, and I ended up taking the turn towards a smaller startup rather than going to a larger company like Microsoft. So I end up in California, and we weather the storm. You know, there was the bubble had burst in 2000. And yet we were working for a startup. This is one of Vinod's company, Vinod Khosla's company, when he was still at Kleiner Perkins back in the year 2000. And we were building a distributed system to really go disrupt some incumbents in the space of data storage, data management. The company didn't go anywhere, but we learned a lot of lessons. In fact, 5-6 of us young folks out of that company also went and created at least $15-20 billion of market cap over time as well. So we were very stubborn, and even though we were not senior people, we kind of learn what not to do, which is build a top-heavy company and not have product management that was relevant. And I mean, because it's really hard to get product management right in most companies. And you could see what not to do. I mean, most experiences don't tell you what to do, but they'll at least tell you what not to do. And I learned that. Then 4 years, I took a hiatus, you know, ended up at Oracle building database software. And that's where I met Bipul Sinha, you know, my partner in crime, who gave the first check for us in 2009. And I worked a couple of years after Oracle at a startup building data warehouse, which is like a snowflake of its time. there was no cloud. You still wanted big data warehouses that would be much less expensive than Oracle and Teradata. So I built a lot of those things for like 10 years. I worked for someone else and there was this itch to go and do something. So the three of us, we knew each other. Ajit and I knew each other from Kanpur days, and Mohit and I knew each other from my startup days, you know, this company which I joined in California in 2000. And we were impatient and we wanted to go do something. And we didn't have an idea as to what we'll go build. We just knew that we wanted to follow our gut. So we quit our job, and this is 2009. And the economy was still mushy, as you know. But I think there was a conviction to go do something, and you know, the rest is history.
Why did you choose to start in a downturn? You could have said, let's wait a couple of years more, let the economy get back.
Yeah. I mean, looking back, we didn't know what we know now about what happens to companies when they start in a recession. And there's a certain correlation, maybe even a causation about starting in a recession, because, you know, people are driven by fear and paranoia and a lot of, I mean, it becomes a defensive market where nobody buys anything. That's the best time to build a new product, because by the time, you know, greed takes over and people are feeling a little bit more optimistic, you know, there's pent up demand. You know, the purse strings open up and people want to go and buy again and experiment again and tinker again. And that's when ideas flourish. So I think it was just right for us. By 2011, 2012, things were opening up again and people were feeling a little cheerful and like, yeah, we can start out with new ideas. And I think this pattern has actually held on for very long, you know, even in the early 90s when there was a recession, or the 2000s after the recession, or after 2009. So I think we were lucky to have actually started in that time. And I think, you know, the thing that I told my wife in 2009, because, you know, you need to have your significant others also be part of this, looks like it's true for you and Nancy as well, is that independent of whether they are really part of the company or not, they're still part of the entrepreneurship journey in many ways, you know. And she and I talked, and I talked. We're like, you know, what's the worst? You know, the worst is we go get back to a job. The worst is not bad enough. You basically jump, and that's what we did. We jumped, and I think we were good at being stubborn and listening at the same time. And obviously, there was luck and all those things come in as well. I mean, we had almost three near-death experiences in the first 3 years, and we didn't give up. And I feel like that is the walking on fire that the market actually does with you, for you, because that's classic Darwinism. You know, if you can walk on fire, then you deserve to survive and thrive. And if you give up, then obviously there's nothing. So when people say there's luck, I feel like you need a lot of hard work and then luck to really make something work.
You have to be prepared for the right place at the right time to happen.
Yeah, I mean, even to survive requires a lot of hard work and then some luck as well. I mean, as you said, you know, our first thesis was that this product will work on top of VMware, and it was a wrong assumption because they were not ready for something as sort of demanding as our software running on top of it. Nobody had run what we were running on top of VMware. And then when we went past that, they went from being a partner to being a foe. Like, you have to compete with somebody you basically work on top of. How do you deal with all that stuff? And how do you compete with that? And, you know, we felt cornered, very similar to the way Apple felt cornered by Google when it came to location services. They didn't have maps and Google had maps, and they were demanding every ounce of flesh from Apple. And that's when they said, look, we're going to do our own maps. And it was clunky to begin with. But I think it was a very similar moment for us as well, because VMware looked us in the eye and said, we'll crush you and kill you. And had to figure out a way to survive. And eventually, I think that moment helped us liberate. And that's what the market loves today about Nutanix, is the fact that they can really get out of the clutches of incumbency and use something that's, you know, much cheaper and much more delightful.
And can you describe some of the milestones that Nutanix went in, which year you achieved them and what it took to achieve them? For example, it can be the first million in ARR, the next 10 million in the next 50 or 100.
Yeah. Well, we didn't have ARR back then. This was still, I mean, we had to shrink wrap our software into commodity hardware because that was a solution. That was a way to plug and play. Just the way Apple insisted they're not going to do software, they're going to do an entire solution. We did that, even though the shrink wrap was commodity hardware. And we had become really good at solving problems for people very fast and quick. And but still start small. It doesn't have to be big. So our first million came in our first quarter of selling, actually. But again, it was...
Which year?
This was late 2011, early 2012. So within 2 years, so after 2 years of building a product, we went out there. And, I mean, granted, it was hardware and there was... And it was still low margin back then because we were still very early and willing to actually say, look, it's almost free if you just buy this thing and so on. But then we did 3 million, then 5 million. These are all quarters. These are not years. 1, 3, 5, 8, 13, 25. So we were probably the fastest to half a billion, you know. Now, it was still hardware, but, you know, to get to those many people willing to pay for it was still not easy, you know. Then we got rid of the hardware. So we almost gave up 30, 35% of our revenue. But in 2016, when we went public, we were doing about 800 million. Still as a hardware-software combination. And we were still growing 70, 80%. And I think if we had not given up hardware, it was 2.5 billion plus, you know, in revenue. But then we gave up hardware and then we gave up these big 5-year deals and 7-year deals. I mean, in Japan, we were doing 7-year deals because that's what they wanted, you know. And then really started to move towards smaller deals. I mean, top 300 customers in Nutanix who probably had paid us almost 3 billion, you know, over the course of 7, 8, 9 years. And I think it was great to have served the large enterprise, but you also realize how the flywheel only comes when you have really small initial consumption, which is what the public cloud really was all about. Like, look, you don't have to commit to anything, pay by the drop, not even by the shot or something. And I think, you know, eventually that was my big epiphany moment as to like, wow, this thing is moving to something even smaller than what we had built, because what we had built was really small compared to the hardware incumbents that were there out there. But we were still selling $50,000, $100,000 worth of things when the public cloud was doing $50. Like our AWS bills till very recently was $1,000 a month or something. You know, you couldn't have done that by shipping things on-prem and having people go deploy it, install it, because it takes... In humans cost money.
And you mentioned that, you know, the recent revenue of Nutanix is $1.6 billion. Mm-hmm. Do you think it's a possibility in the recent years, in the next few years, it can be a $10 billion revenue company?
I think if they were to transform to a true cloud business, because, you know, we thought we were invisible infrastructure, but the cloud was even more invisible, right? Because I think the thing for me was that, look, we've not made it invisible enough. People still need to ship it and rack stack and mount it. And yeah, we've taken 3-4 different hardware products and made it into one solution, but it's still quite visible. And you still need to go through channel and 2 tiers of distribution and, you know, some level of professional services. So there's a lot of visible stuff going on in invisible infrastructure. But it was the most simplest invisible infrastructure on-prem, where if you had to build your own data center. I think the public cloud and the idea of streaming as opposed to owning has just gained immense ground in the last 5 years. So if Nutanix were to go down that path and figure out what multi-cloud means and how do you really have people provide the optionality of multiple clouds, I think that is going to be a home run.
So becoming a public company really changed your life from a...
I don't think so. I mean, you know, a lot of people, I enjoyed it. I mean, for almost 5 years, even though we were going through massive transitions in business model and things like that, I felt like, you know, it was basically a milestone in the overall journey of any company. And, you know, you take a view that what has to be done has to be done. Had we not been a subscription company by the end of 2020, we probably would have been a whole lot less relevant. You know? So at least for me, I feel like going public is a means to an end. It gives you better branding, a better enterprise recall, brand recall, because large enterprises actually want to look at your books and see, you know, how much money do you make and are you relevant? And going public helps with a lot of that as well. You know? But I think by and large, being balanced between Wall Street and Main Street, because Main Street pays the bills. Right. I mean, in many ways, you have to look at them as the first customer and then look at your employee, then look at Wall Street. You know? And I think how you balance the three legs of the stool, I think it's a lot of fun. You know, and for many people, it's like, oh, it's a zero-sum game. If you did too much for Main Street, you won't do enough for Wall Street. If you did too much for Wall Street, you would forget the Main Street. I think it can be done. And the best companies in the world actually do that, you know, really well.
And what's your aspiration for DevRev? Do you want to build a better company or a bigger company than Nutanix?
I think the aspiration is to go build something that's delightful. So rather than go put an outcome or a number or a size, I think it's too early. I mean, in fact, who knows? Maybe we were wrong in a few things. We'll learn about those things. But if you can bring delight, then I think that's the karma that will pay the bills, and that, you know, basically the customer love will be there. You know, I mean, we did a really good job of customer love at Nutanix, but our cost of distribution was high. And that's just basically me not taking risks of what distribution meant and something. Like when Tesla said you can do direct to the customer, it raised a lot of hackles. Like, what? You can bypass the dealership? And the public cloud did exactly that. They had a direct connect between the user and them, you know, end user and them. So I want to be able to apply some of those consumer grade lessons to DevRev and see where it goes.
I think public cloud is one of the reasons why entrepreneurship blossomed.
In fact, there's a really good read, maybe a couple of pages that you might have remembered from the book Sapiens. Yuval Harari talks about the discovery of fire. And he basically conjectures as to why Homo sapiens really became the more intelligent species. This is obviously a hypothesis, but he says, look, there's two parts of your body that absorb the most amount of energy, the gut and the brain. That's it. You know, more than 80% of the energy actually goes to the gut or the brain, to digest food or to really make you think. And before fire, there was raw meat, and you need much longer intestine to really digest the raw meat. But with fire, you had cooked meat. So evolution basically said, look, you can get rid of some of the length of the intestine. It can actually be a short route. And with that, he conjectures that the brain started to get more energy. The public cloud is not raw meat. It's cooked meat. So it has basically resulted in developers focusing on bigger, better things because they have a better brain. They have more mind space. There's a lot of on-prem was actually raw meat. You know? And I think it will be basically the reason why there's so much more people trying things out and really tinkering with things, ideas, because it's $10 a month as opposed to $10,000 or $100,000.
And Dheeraj, in your personal life, right, what kind of a person are you? You have to describe yourself.
You know, at least I can tell you what I aspire to be. I aspire to breathe more, breathe well, you know, because with breathing, you can actually control your automatic behavior, which is, you know, whatever it could be. You know, I think I want to sleep more and sleep well, and I want to smile more and smile, you know, a lot. I mean, some level, these three things are very disarming, and, you know, and I want to do a lot of that. And I want to keep reminding myself that you breathe well, you know, sleep well, and smile more. I actually like the word paradox a lot, because most things in life are a balance. It's yin yang between two opposites. So I tend to rationalize things as like, well, this is the way things are in life. You know, if you're walking a tightrope and you lean too much towards one side, you'll fall. And the goal is to really figure out how to do this tightrope walk. And, you know, my wife and I, we have three kids and, you know, enjoy travel. And I personally enjoy history a lot. So, I mean, big history buff. I do a lot of Wikipedia free falling and, you know, watching the History Channel and remembering stuff. I have a way of remembering and really stashing things away in my own library so I can go back to the wars and the people. And I really believe that history doesn't repeat, but it rhymes, as someone said very famously. So you can do some pattern matching and you can learn from the past to really go and make some decisions in the future. So, yeah, history plays a big role. And I think in the last 15 years, I've learned and respected a lot about design. I was an empathetic person even before that. But I think growing with Apple since 2009 has made me appreciate many more things than I ever was. I think I had a good taste for things, but I really honed a lot of these things around me about what good looks like. That's why at DevRev, we have a ton of designers, you know. And I mean, only with design can we go and change the ecosystem that's so siloed.
And what do you do? Like, if you could describe your day on a typical basis, how much time you spend in DevRev?
And
your hobbies, like reading.
So on the side, we have a family office that's run by our chief investment officer and his team. We have a family foundation. We just gifted $10 million to UT Austin, Texas Austin, not just for gratitude, but also learning, being a fly on the wall with researchers doing computational oncology. So we're trying to converge people there as well. You know, there is Dell Medical School, there are researchers there, there are the machine learning lab, and then there are these biophysicists who've been basically working on simple statistical models around cancer research. So I, you know, feel like we can be a fly on the wall and learn about how to age well and what it means to learn from the cutting edge research that's really going to blur the lines between computing and biology. You know, I mean, if anything, what we saw with the mRNA vaccine is the fact that 3D printing of the mRNA, which is really computing at large, and what biology is, really lines are blurred. And those things are happening in other sensors like CAR T, where you can program the cell to know which tumor cells to kill or not. I mean, even CRISPR, that was a big innovation in terms of editing the gene. So there's a lot of those things that we are really interested in. We have invested quite a few life sciences companies, you know, biotech companies. And so I think that's a whole lot. I mean, DevRev still takes up 90%+ of my personal time. I have started to code again. You know, at 46, I'm learning JavaScript, TypeScript, React, and even Go. And because that's one way I can actually show to my own people that, look, you know, don't get tribal in your comfort zone of, oh, I'm just a backend person, just a front-end person, you know, because what really matters is the nation, and that nation is the company. And, you know, you need to really think top down about the customer and the end user and the experience rather than my little thing. And we have really created this movement around microservices and this and that, but eventually it's very bottom up way of thinking about things. And you've ended up fragmented a lot of engineers to just think about their little thing, which is a tribe called a microservice. And then you kind of delegate everything to PMs and designers. So I think being a full stack person, where you can be a generalist and be a single threaded owner of a feature, Amazon talks about that quite a bit, about single threaded ownership. But the way to really get it going is having full stack people. So I'm actually doing full stack development to just show our own people. We're having a rally right now in Bangalore where about 70, 80 people, including 20 interns, are actually working on things. But you know, it's keeping me really fresh as well, you know, because then I can know how hard something is.
And then how do you figure out time for reading or for other stuff?
You know, it's like breathing, you know, you don't think about those things. So I still read a lot and I still stash a lot away. One of my favorite apps on iOS is Pocket. I'm sure, you know, you probably used it, but I used it like really diligently. Like every day I have like 10 pieces that I've read, and then I forward it to other people. But that's the way I remember, like, how do you really connect the dots?
Well, thank you so much, Dheeraj. And my last question is, like, when you're looking to invest, like you invested in Vijay's company, some other company, you know, founder's company, what are you really looking for?
You know, it's the team. And I mean, it's a very cliched way of saying this, but I feel like it's, if they have a sense of design and empathy, then they'll figure it out. And design would mean that they'll reduce friction with the end user, but also they'll think about design of the organization and design of the Salesforce and design of marketing and all that. So I think anybody who's very design centric, but at the same time, you know, has the worldliness of dealing with people and, you know, highly just learning skill, it's like fast learners. So they're actually evolving faster than the company, because many a time founders, they start to get pushed by the company because they're not evolving fast enough. And yet there are those who actually pull the company because they're evolving faster than the company. So you look for some signals around that.
Thank you so much. It's been a pleasure. Right?
Yeah, I mean, you also brought a lot of this sort of push me to think through this conversation. And I appreciate that. And thank you to the audience who actually listened through this very long and, you know, last hour or so.